Before I start doing something here, I would ask you to do something here. So I will try to involve you people into this workshop by using Twitter and personal communication. So I will start directly with a practice for you. Please start right now, and I will come back to you with the results in 10 minutes. If you are now sitting together with a coworker, please shuffle, search for someone else who you possibly don't know yet, and sit beside someone you don't know yet so you can exchange with new people here. If you're not sitting beside someone, please try to build pairs and sit together so that you can actually work together. And then discuss, after telling each other your name, of course, discuss what you think clean code is. And without looking on the internet, of course, without looking it up in Wikipedia, what means clean code for you. And please tweet to our company account, Quafu, with the hashtag WebSC, your answers, and we will discuss them in 10 minutes. Shoot. This might have been a little bit strange for you, but when I'm doing workshops, I always let my participants start with some practice where they need to think something on their own and which connects them to the topic. I think this is really important to first get into a mood of I'm here to do something and not I'm just here to listening, especially after lunch. So we will come back in a minute to your tweets about what you think is clean code. First, some words about me. My name is Tobias Schlitt. You might have already read that. So I'm Toby. Hi, welcome in this workshop. I'm working for a company called Quafu. Wow, you can barely see that. What are we doing at Quafu? So if you have legacy code lying around, if you have performance issues, architectural challenges, or if your team just needs a boost, you can call us and we will come over and support you with workshops like this. So normally I do workshops with up to 8 people. So this is a little bit larger and also you are completely mixed from teams. This is why I thought up on how can I make you participate and how can I support this working together thing. The first thing was mixing you and making sure that there is exchange between you people, knowledge exchange, because that is, from my experience, much more effective than just listening to me ranting my slides down. So please exchange with your table neighbor. Who of you has not brought any code to work on? So as everybody, some pieces of code lurking around on his hard disk where you can just jump in and work on, or are there people who don't have that? Okay, so awesome. Everybody follow the instructions. If not, so, or if you think, well, no, I'm not comfortable working on my own code, or I'm not comfortable showing little snippets from my code or whatever, feel free to download the 2 example files I will be using during this workshop, so you can work on them if you want to, but I would be much happier if you work on your own code and give us a little insights on how you make your code better during the session today. We will be doing practices in between, and I thought Twitter might be a good medium for you to contribute to the workshop and show what you did during the workshop. So whenever there is a practice slide, I added this tweet information, and I have a little Twitter wall on my notebook so we can look into that together. Please use @Quafu, which is my company account, to address me, and the WebSC so everybody else can also see that. If you're not comfortable with tweeting or if you're not on Twitter, don't hesitate to come forward and tell me your changes by myself or raise your hand and I will come around. So this should be really an interactive thing. Oh, it's underscores. I'm so sorry. It should be underscores instead of dashes. Oh, give me a second. I will fix that. Oh, you're sure. That's an awesome start for a workshop. Awesome stuff. Let me give it a check. Oh, it's clean code practice. Damn. Okay, that should be working. I will provide another fix. Okay, so I'm pretty interested on how this will work and if this would work. So whenever you change some code during this workshop and you think it's like worth it, or if you have questions, or if you want us to look at a piece of code together, just use gist to do a little paste of like one method or some lines of code or a diff or whatever you have to be talking about, and put it into a tweet so I can display it on the Beamer here in front and we can discuss it together. So I hope this will be really becoming interactive, but let's see if that works out. So let's take a look at what people in the room think that clean code is. Okay, we have quite some answers here. Is it readable from the back? Yes. Please give me a sign if it's not readable. Okay, great. So we have the answer. Clean code is like teenage sex. Everyone talks about it. Few really know how to do it. Everybody thinks everybody else is doing it, so everybody claims they are doing it. Well, that explains it very well, although it's very meta kind of answer, so not really on the topics.
Well, to be honest, it's exactly to add the topic, because we all talk about solid principles and we try to use the law of the meter and proper variable meaning and separation of concerns and everything. And then the wall of reality and deadlines just hits us. And then in that last leg, like we just shovel it in and ship it out, and hopefully we will have time to refactor it later. And that's exactly my point.
Yes, I fully agree with you. So, but it did not cover, like, now you stated like, oh, variable naming, this is part of clean code. But sure, it's a meta kind of answer. So I actually agree with you. So many, many people are claiming like we are doing good coding, we are doing high quality coding, and well, everybody knows exactly what you're talking about. By the end of the sprint, right before shipping, everybody's just hacking stuff in and is hoping to get it done later or get it clean later. Okay, so we have another answer. There is no else statements and following the solid principles. Anybody wants to discuss that? Okay.
Else is evil.
Else is evil.
Yes.
Oh, I would not 100% agree with you.
No, I'm not completely evil, but in like 90% of the cases, just don't do it. Like, if you need to have a branch without a really good reason, exit early.
Yeah. So the basic answer was like, instead of doing if else, you do early return inside the if part and then do the else part right after the if statement. That fits quite well into a clean code, because you need to extract methods in order to do that right now, and we will see that later on. Absolutely true. We have all those good principles like solid law of Demeter, proper naming, using good design patterns, composing instead of inheritance. I would fully agree with most of the parts, so at least clean code is highly related to that. We have minimal onboarding time. Who tweeted that? So I like that one especially, and I will come back on one of the slides, like the next one or the thing after it, coming back to minimal onboarding time. I really, really like this answer. And there was an additional answer like realize you write shitty code yourself, which I also like very much. So just realizing that everybody is doing mistakes all over the day when writing code is a very important start for writing better code by the end of the day. Okay, so this Twitter thingy seemed to work quite well. I hope it will also work for the next practices. So in the end, clean code, as we know the topic clean code, is a set of established rules which help you to become a better programmer, which help you to write better code. This is easy said, but we will see in detail what it means. Clean code does not only make you touch your code, but also touches your working environment, how you go on with your colleagues, how you work together, and how you feel responsible for your work and the work you are doing together. So it's a basic handbook of what we call agile development. The question is, how much do you invest into productivity? I have a question for you all. How much time do you spend during a normal working day actually writing code? So what fraction of time do you spend actually typing code? A little louder? 30%. Oh, I think that's really much. So 30% pure typing, that is like, I think it's quite much. Anybody else thinks he types more? So how much fraction of your time do you spend typing code?
Half, maybe more.
Half or maybe more? You're working on greenfield projects, right? Okay, so really long-term project work. Oh, well, so if you really manage 50% of typing the day, that is really, really good fraction. That's really, really high productivity.
I wish it was lower.
You wish it was lower?
Yeah.
Why? Yeah.
To get a better solution instead of one that just works.
Well, this is an important thing what you're saying there. But if you still manage to put like 50 or even 70% of your daily time into coding work, then it does not seem like you have a problem. So the typical thing here is that as a developer, we do not spend, or most of us do not spend, even 30 to 50% time actually writing code, but we spend like 10% of our time writing code, and the remaining time we are reading code. Well, this is like the normal thing. You want to fix a bug, right? So what do? You open up files and you start reading the code. And before you even can change one line of code, you spend like an hour digging into the code and finding the places where you actually want to change something. And then you change something and realize, well, that didn't produce the result I want, so you change it back. And then you read on and on and on. And if you want to implement a feature, it's the same thing. You're looking like, oh, where's the right place to do that? So if you have a team which is larger than just two persons, maybe you have four, five, six persons, and maybe you have a project which is running for longer than a month, it will just take you time searching through your code and finding a good place to do that. And this is where clean code actually jumps on. So this is what you also say, what you actually want to do. Instead of optimizing our code for writing it fast, we should rather think about investing some more time in writing and then optimizing the code for readability instead of writability. So instead of just hacking fast, 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 I need that fast, I need that now, we should rather think a little bit more on, okay, is this the appropriate place? Is this the appropriate way of doing that? Naming such a variable like that, is it really a good thing? Is this the method which belongs into this class? And then we make it easier for us to spend less time on the need to read through our code and to find the right place. So this is exactly that on the slides. The term clean code was actually made famous by Robert C. Martin, aka Uncle Bob, and he wrote a really good book. So if you don't have that for your team, I recommend buying that on Amazon and to force all of your team members to read it or to buy a Kafu workshop so we can teach it to you. What is even more important for me on the clean code thing, beside all the rules which say like, oh, you should do that, you shouldn't do that, and so on, is that it's a matter of attitude. We should all feel responsible for the code we are working on. Even if a coworker actually crafted the code, even if it's legacy code and everybody's like, wow, this code is so shitty, I hate it, I need to fix all the time, and it's so complex, and there are no tests. Well, in the end, now it's your code, and you should feel responsible for this code. And as soon as you feel responsible for the code, you will inherently make it better. Also, we should be working together as a team. We should not be working against each other. We should not be working like, my boss wrote that code, I won't touch it. Anybody ever thought like, well, this is a code from that and that coworker, I should not touch it, he might be angry? So I've been there. Yeah, you've been there too?
On both sides.
On both sides, yeah.
There is a code that they specifically say, like, don't ever touch. I'm not certain what it does.
Yes.
Yeah.
This is our topic for another workshop. I could do like a session on that. Okay. One really important thing I learned from clean code is the so-called Boy Scout rule. You all know the Boy Scout rule? Anybody can tell me what the Boy Scout rule says? So the Boy Scout rule says every time you leave the camping ground, leave it in a better state than you found it. And this is the thing behind clean code. So whenever you touch some part of the code, or whenever you look at parts of your code, you should be leaving it in a better state than you found it. And that's really easy to do. And we will learn today how we can do that and how we get that into our mindset. Also, it's important to share a common set of rules so nobody works in a completely different direction than the other team members do. So, coming down from this meta level of talking about clean code, let's actually look at some of the rules there and actually practice them. So the first part we are looking at is naming of things. And this was already mentioned by some of you through Twitter or in the discussion here in the room. Naming things is rather hard and it's rather important inside our working condition as programmers. Just to make sure, everybody is a programmer here, right? Good. So, whenever we have a bad name, something that is not telling us what the artifact we are looking at is actually doing and how we are meant to be using it, we have a hard time reading through variables, classes, methods, and files. The idea of clear naming is that the code is actually talking to you. So instead of just looking on it and saying like, well, it's an algorithm, you should be like, how? Oh, we are doing that here. We are fetching products from a database, and out there we are filtering products, and so on. So while reading the code, we should really understand it as if we were reading a book. So if you just think a little bit back into the times when programming actually started, so the first computers, then we had only these cards which had holes, right? There are zero or one holes, and well, that's all. So back in these times, we had to write programs which were actually readable by a machine. This is not true anymore today. We have PHP and other higher level languages which allow us to write code in a way that it's readable by a human. It's easy to write code which can be executed by a machine. So you just need to follow the syntax of your programming language. But this is not the idea. The idea is to write a program in a way that a human can actually read it too. And this is where it becomes challenging. And this is where we say like, well, the code should be talking to me. Otherwise, we can just go back and write assembly. This is much easier for a machine to read, right? It's much faster to be translated and much faster to be executed. But nobody understands it. And so we invented all these high-level programming languages, concepts, and so on to make the code more readable for us. So we should actually use this power of the programming language instead of working against it. Yeah, that's what I just said, or what I was claiming quite for another. There is one point here which is also very important. So while writing code, which might be very intuitive for you, it might not be intuitive for others. We will jump on that bandwagon a little bit later again. So what does actually a good name make? So a good name for anything that you have in your program is it explains why the thing actually exists. So what is the purpose of the thing? What it does for you? So what is the effect of calling a method? What is the expected result? I just had a discussion during lunch where somebody said, like, well, there was a method named is something, and I expected it to return a Boolean. And what it actually did, it was it changed the state of the object. Well, that's like one of the worst things that can happen to you, right? If you read something and your expectation is completely different to what it's actually doing. And it should be explained how to use that artifact. General, I would give you the rule, if you have the feeling that you need to add a comment to a name for something, explaining why you named a variable like something, why you named a class like something, if you want to write a comment explaining what the class does, you got a bad name. And this is also a good approach of looking through your application and actually finding bad names. Just look at the comments. We will be talking about comments later on too. Rarely, abbreviations are good names. So, of course, I'm not talking about HTTP as an abbreviation. In the web environment, we can accept that. But if you have, like, prod, oh, what is that? Maybe it's a product, maybe it's produced, maybe it's whatever. I don't know. There are many, many teams working in, like, fixed naming abbreviations, and if new members join the team, they're like, whoa, I have no clue what you're doing here. So nowadays, we all have some kind of IDE which supports some kind of auto-completion. Even me, working purely on the shell, only working with VI, even VI has auto-completion, so it's not a bad thing to use a variable name which is longer than 3 characters. Also, please don't follow like modern languages like the Go language, for example, which still thinks keywords need to be abbreviated. So they're actually abbreviating function by writing func, which is like, they could have left out the C, then it would even be fun, but well, they didn't. So let's take a look at a little bit of code, and maybe we find already some things which we can discuss. So, to illustrate that, I picked an example from a project which I actually had to look at. And okay, I admit I made it a little bit worse. If you downloaded the zip file, you can actually look into that yourself. So, what do we do? We create some item with some number. We call some really, really, really fancy method on that, another item. We create an instance of the class data. We maybe put something into this data, so the method is called in, not sure. We're asking it if there is something in it. We get all from it, and well, it should be runnable. Yeah, it actually is. So you see that there are certain things to be spit out and so on. So let's jump into the code. Oh. I found the first thing which is really bad here. So we have a class item that might be sensible, but inside it has some prodit. Anybody making a guess what that could be? Oh, product ID. You're very smart. So in sense of clean code, what should we be doing right now?
Renaming it.
Well, renaming it, and that is awesomely easy because this is just a private variable inside of a class. This is the best thing you can do besides renaming a local variable, is changing private and protected members of a class. Protected are even a little bit more dangerous, but changing privates is very, very, very easy. So we can just say, like, I have this prodit thing here. We name it to product ID. So, by renaming that, we even got clearer insight into the constructor. So we now see how well this is created with a product ID, and it's mandatory to add the product ID during construction. That makes it rather readable. What we can infer from that is basically that item was most probably a bad name for the class. Anybody has an idea what could be a better name? Product would be nice, yeah. So let's just change that one. Oh, so I also found a change here. So this data thing seems to accept products. And by having a speaking name as the type hint here, it makes it much easier for me to infer what actually happens in that case, instead of just being capable of adding items there. And so we could run like through all this code and touch everything. Of course, changing class names is not something which is really easy in PHP. If you are working on a language like Java, which is strictly typed, this gets much easier because your IDE can 100% surely exchange the class name everywhere by refactoring. This is not possible in PHP because we have dynamic typing and we can do things like creating object instances out of strings or something like that. But still, your IDE assists that, and hopefully you have some tests which you can simply run. We will also jump on that later in the workshop, which assists you in doing things in the right way. So, in us talking by me, I give you 15 minutes of time. I would ask you to work together with the partner at your table. So pick one of your code bases of either people and just look through the code base and see how the names look like in your code base. And especially if your table neighbor is capable of easily understanding what a name means, or if you can maybe improve the naming. It must not be large changes. Small changes can just be easy. The code must not be runnable, of course, afterwards, so you don't need to pay attention right now to do a proper refactoring here. Just discuss the code, just discuss the naming, and find changes. If you have changed something, it would be awesome if you create a gist, either with previous state and now state, or you can actually use a diff and paste it and then tweet it to us so we can show that on the slides here before. Otherwise, I will be hacking some more about the example, but I find it much more valuable if I get code examples from your side. Also, if you want to walk around, if you want to look what anybody else is doing here, if you want to turn the tables to get more creative atmosphere, just don't hesitate of doing that. So this thing is for you doing stuff here. It's a workshop. It's not like ranting in school. So 15 minutes of time. Enjoy. Okay, sadly we don't have a full date of time for this workshop. So please come to an end now and provide me with some results. If you have, otherwise we have already three results, so that's pretty nice. So, let's look at the first one. This is like a very good example. I think it's from the very back there, over there. So, would you mind coming to the front and telling something, or should I explain something? Okay, so as far as I can see, we have something that is named PDF service, so I think it will generate some PDF out of something. And it has some interesting private variables in here, or properties in here, which originally were named just capital B, capital I, capital U. Well, I saw the original code and it was like much, much more in there. So. People change these variables to be named bold, italic, and underlined. So it's much, much easier to now understand what these property actually means. Are you already satisfied with the result, or do you think it could be even improved more?
It probably could be improved more, but I would have to spend quite time reading through the whole file.
And So, do you know if these are actually Boolean parameters, or if it's just what the contents of the variables is?
I'm not really sure.
So, that would be a really, really interesting thing, because if you have like bold, italic, and underline, you still don't know how to handle these variables. So, investigating the code more, and maybe checking if it's really Boolean variables, so we can name them like make text italic or something, or put text italic or something, so that the reader of the variable actually knows how to use the variable properly. So there is another thing here. Oh, you renamed width and height, of course. Like, one letter.
I would also like to change the R, but I'm not sure what R is. So.
Oh, it's okay. So you're not sure what R is. So you skipped it for now. That would be like what I call code archaeology, basically. So investigating code, which we have no clue what it actually does. And whenever you are doing that, and I'm pretty sure every one of you is doing that on a daily basis in one or more projects, whenever you find such a thing and whenever you investigate it, what does that thing do? Take 5 minutes of time and try to fix it and to see if you can rename that properly. Great. Thanks for the really great example. I think I need to reload that one. Did you edit the GIS to add a new version? Oh, so it uses the revisions. Let's see. Ah, okay, so I see you just started with the original GIST and then you changed stuff. Okay. So this is the original version, right? So these people found a method which was called read member attributes, and it has a parameter data. Did you find out what data actually is? Oh, you actually, so you actually renamed it. So whenever you find a variable called data, that's a really, really, really bad thing because every variable contains obviously data. So just naming something data is the worst thing which you can do in a program. So the first fix they applied was renaming data to attributes, which gives a much better idea of what is in there. So people think like, well, this must be a hash map of attributes which are coming from some external thing because we want to read them. The second thing they found, and I can tell you I saw the code, there were like 60 lines in between or something, and then it did this store. So while it named read member attributes, and nobody ever would think that it does perform a database action or a file execution, it still did. So they renamed the method to store member attributes. So it's much more obvious for people if they call that they actually produce some database access, some I/O in the background. Did you ever jump into that trap that you think something is really safe to be called and inside it changed the state? Yeah, you're nodding. So this is really, really bad because you will produce, for example, performance penalties without even knowing that. One popular thing is if you have an object relational mapper and it automatically lazy loads attributes or related objects for you. And you just iterate over whatever thing and think like, wow, why is it so slow now? Yeah, you just executed 60 or more select statements to the database without even realizing that. So also a really good example. Did you do some more?
No.
Okay. Great. Then we have some more here. Okay. Can somebody tell me what you did here?
Yeah, I renamed the plugin name from PA1 to PA3, PA4 to some
switching one. Oh, okay. So you changed the parameters actually. So it's the things on disk, right? So these are the plugins which are loaded, correct? And instead of having TX content plugin 1, TX content plugin 2, TX content plugin 3, we now have actually speaking names, which are TX content standard, image content, featured box content, and so on. So just renaming some files which you read from disk makes it much easier to understand where something actually happens and what. And I'm pretty sure there is, lots of potential to improve this much more. Add PI to ST4. I don't even know how to pronounce that. So, really good example. Okay. Oh, this is the thing I was talking about with autocomplete, right?
That is type of three.
Yeah, okay. Great. So, let me see if we have more results here and can invest some more time in looking. Okay, can I simply click the link? S- So, what do we have here? Who sent this? Can you tell me shortly what you did?
I had variable names for value.
Yeah. Yeah, that's really good. So I see that here right now. So originally the name was value. I mean, value is almost as good as data, right? So from reading, it's like every variable should obviously have a value. Well, maybe if it's not initialized, it doesn't have a value, but we can argue on that one. So it was renamed to start timestamp and end timestamp, and then we had day and day two, which is also, well, day is even, it's better than value. But you have no idea of what to do with the day, and especially not with the day two. So renaming that to start time and end time is really, really much, much better and makes the code much more readable. So did I forget more once? Let's see. So who pasted that? Okay, what is it? Okay, you don't know. It's just some code, and okay, let's.
About a form where you alter the form to add some fields to it.
Okay. So.
Yeah, I don't remember what CCB is.
Okay, so you don't remember what CCB is, so you couldn't rename that?
No. What I did see is that I both use camel case and snake case in the same piece of code. So
yeah. So you change to what we will talk about that a little bit later too, but only roughly. So changing a code to apply to a common coding standard is a very important thing. We will discuss that a little bit later. So we don't know what CCB is, but instead we changed the name to conform to this. Then we have is values array set, and it's now renamed to has array value set, which is much more clean to read in this case. So it's now, it's proper English, right? And you can even understand the variable name as a sentence. You know what the condition inherits here. Okay, so do we have more? Yeah, ah, okay, so this is actually foreign language?
Yeah, that's in Dutch. Well,
it's Dutch?
The code is in English.
Okay, so you changed from Dutch to English. This is a thing which you can actually argue about, but I'm agreeing with you. Personally, I would rather go with all of my code in English and don't have German names in that or other foreign languages names, especially then you can easily exchange that with international people, and it looks much cleaner because all the programming languages are English. And for me, as a German, well, it is a huge improvement to have this variable renamed, because otherwise I would have used Google Translate to even understand the code, which, well, might not be the sense of it. Great, thanks. Oh, and we have somebody working on the example code. So we changed P1 to product 1, changed the class name. Then we have... renamed the class data to stock, which is much more speaking, so it's obviously containing, is it readable? I hope so. Which is obviously a collection of products which are on stock. So we are setting products into the stock. We are checking the product stock if there is something in there from product one. We are retrieving all products from the stock, and as you can see, it's much more readable than before. So investigating the code, how much time did it took you to investigate it? Who pasted it? Yeah, so how much time did you actually invest of the 15 minutes in understanding what the code does?
Two-thirds
of the time you used. And so it was like 5 minutes writing the code and 10 minutes reading the code. Next time, I'm pretty sure you will read this code much, much faster. So achievement unlocked, I would say. Great. So I'm sorry if I missed some of the contribution. I really, really love that you all work on that and that you all provide your examples. This is really, really good workshop spirit in here. To close this naming topic, there are some rules of thumb which you should obey to when doing naming of things. So most of you know that if you name a class, this is most probably a noun. If you have a strategy pattern implemented, it might not be a noun, but rather a verb or something like that. There are some names for classes which you should try to strictly avoid. And whenever you name something in that direction, it should be triggering an alarm bell in your brain telling you, well, there is something wrong here. And this is whenever you name something manager. So what does a manager do? Yeah, he manages, of course. So what does managing mean? Well, nobody really knows that. So we shouldn't do that for a class. Also, processor. Yeah, well, it processes data. Let me think. What else does my program do? Processing data might be a good thing. In the easy publish world, like 5 years ago, everything was a handler. Nowadays, everything is a service, by the way. So if you name a class service, well, you might rethink that. So just service is a bad name. Also, I tend to dislike appending service to every worker class. So not sure if that is a good idea. Also, if you're working with methods, having a verb in a method name is a really good thing because methods actually do something. And it's really, really good if you indicate that there is something ongoing in there, so some state change, like something is deleted, something is posted, or if it's just reading something, so like has something, is something, get something. While the get something thingy, it's also, I'm really biased on that one. Typically, you have get ID or something just as returning the internal state of the object. Now, if you use that for loading stuff from a database, I would rather go for find, for example, which makes it much clearer that you're actually performing IO operation and not just retrieving state from memory. Has warranty could write something? Okay. Also, if you use that in direction of having a sentence with a name, so product has warranty would actually set that thing. I would personally not do that, but well, it might be that in your team this is the typical way of doing things, and this is an important aspect here. You should agree together with your team on something which you find most logical. So if it's more logical for you to have that as a setter for this product has warranty, I would agree on that one. I personally would rather for writing, I would even change that to like make has warranty or prolong warranty or something, or enhance, extend warranty or something like that. Put into warranty or something so that you explicitly have like, well, this is doing something. But well, it's always discussable. Naming is like always also a matter of personal taste. Okay, what you should strictly avoid is encoding types into your variables, especially since they can change quite fast. So if you say like, this is an array, well, if you change that to array object, it will behave quite differently. If you implement your own collection afterwards, it will behave quite differently. If your IDs were integers previously and now you are changing to whatever new format and now they are strings, you have all these encoding things working around, so not a good thing. And it's not a pure rule, but 3 characters for a variable name are typically too short. Of course, I'm also a fan of just naming something ID, because I know what it means, but, well, some people actually argue identifier would be better. No offense here. So, the next topic we'll be talking about is coding structure. Again, the question is, how much time do I need to understand a certain part of code? And if you have a certain structure in code, it makes it easier to understand it. For example, if you have short methods, and that's not only the number of lines in a method, there can be methods which have like 60 or even 100 lines, and they are pretty easy to understand because it's just a batch process going from top to bottom. Like update users or something like that, or whatever you think. And it just touches a lot of data sets and does a lot, many things in there. However, if you look into a method and determine if it's short, you should rather look at the control structures and the number of control structures in a method. If there is more than 2 or 3 control structures in one method, it starts to get complex for our brain. So working through all the code, if it's just linear without any if, else, while, for each, whatever thing, it's pretty easy for us to read. As soon as you get a condition in there, it's hard to read. You already said if you have conditions with then and else branches, it's even more complex. So reducing the else branches is a pretty good thing, and instead returning early. If you have nested control structures, it's even worse. So looking for shortness in terms of code pieces, rather look at the number of control structures in there than by the number of lines of code. Also, the number of arguments might be quite interesting. So if you have 3 arguments to a method, that might be okay. If you have 10, this is rather complex, because in our brain, in order to work through this method, we need to keep all these 10 variables in mind and what they most probably have as the values. So if you have more variables, more parameters to a function, the bigger gets the model in our brain that we need to have in order to understand what the method does. The same applies, of course, to classes. So the more methods we have in a class, the harder it is to see through and find our way through the class, which does not mean that you should only have one utterly large method there, but having like 100 of methods in one class is also maybe not a good thing. The number of dependencies is really important, because these dependencies even blow up your mind model more. These are like the state of your object, and you need to be aware what changes are made to the dependencies when executing the code. So as programmers, reading is not only bound, or the ability to read code fast is not only bound to the names we are using, but also to the mental model we need to create in order to understand a certain program. And this mental model needs to grow with all dependencies that we have. Another thing which grows our mental model is side effects and global state. So I think this is the... it's a little bit later. As soon as we have side effects from our program, it actually makes the mental model explode in our mind. Do you know some side effects in PHP?
Which one?
Any kind of. So, do you know any side effects in any program? So, changing the database, for example, is always a side effect. It's not only affecting our local memory thingy, which we are just looking at, but it's persisted between different executions of the method. So whenever we change something which does not only affect the current local state, we are executing a side effect. That means it affects other code which will access the same data. So by just reading a user, you don't produce any side effects. By updating its birth date, you're producing side effects to other code, because other code will rely on that the birth date is something which you had before. There is another very, very nasty side effect in PHP programs, all versions, including 7 and 7.1.
Writing a file?
Yeah, writing a file. That's much similar to writing a database. Actually, you're writing a file in some case and you don't notice it. Rail, writing to the session. This is like not even side effect, which is, okay, we have one central storage and we know that if we change that in some table row, then it is changed for all and every accesses. But in the session, it's only changed for a specific user and code accessing this specific user information. So this is even a side effect which is harder to keep in our mind, writing to the session, because we are not only in a global data storage thing, we are not in a local memory thingy, but we are somewhere in between, like, well, if we now access the page with a different user, then it's not there in the session. So it makes it even more complex to think about. Generally, we want to avoid such side effects. So if you look into, for example, functional programming, like it's done in Scheme, for example, or in Haskell, then these programming languages try to avoid side effects and global states as much as possible, with the result that they need to invent rather complex mechanisms to execute the side effects in the end, because we cannot work around. right? As web developers, we cannot work without writing stuff to the database. We can hardly work with writing stuff to the session. We can hardly work with outputting stuff to the screen, just writing HTML out. What we should do in order to manage this complexity in our mental model is to encapsulate the places where we actually perform the side effects into single places. If you, for example, look at Symfony, it has very good place for the side effects that concern the output to the browser. And it's the response object, right? So whenever you have something to be outputted to the browser, you will encapsulate that into one specific kind of object in one class, that's the response, and that is then used to transmit that actually to the browser. With that technique, we allow us to know whenever we produce this side effect by creating a response. And we even can control the whole application, if we do it right, that it does not produce unwanted side effects by just capturing this response thing. And that's the idea behind encapsulating or even avoiding these side effect things. Another point is that we should try to operate on the same level of abstraction. This is going a little bit far for our workshop today, but what it means is if you have dependencies to different other objects, try to see that they are working on the same level. So if you have a dependency to a user service, which allows you to execute business actions on a user, and at the same time you have a dependency to a PDO or doctrine, you're doing something wrong. Because you're not on the level where you should have direct access to the database now, but instead you should work against the business layer, and this one most probably works against the database. So if you have these fancy mixtures, it might be an indicator that you're doing things wrong. But time does not permit me to go into that much details on that fact. So some guidelines, 2 to 3 control structures, the 20 lines, it's what is recommended in clean code. I don't agree with that. So I can easily write 30 lines of code in a method and it's really, really, really still readable. And ripping this method apart would not gain us more readability, but instead I would need to jump through the file in order to see what happens all in there. But going for the control structures is a very good thing. 5 to 10 methods per class, it's a rule of thumb to reduce like that. So if you find a class which has like 30 methods or something, it's a good idea to look into how to rip them apart. Maybe. But again, all these things are, yeah, they are discussable from time to time. It's, you need to look at the specific case and need to find out if this is really true here. What can we do in order to optimize our code in that direction? So we can first off start to break logic into meaningful pieces. And this is the first thing you should ever do when you want to break up some method or break up some structure. It's not ripping out some snippets of code and putting them into a method, but instead structuring the code in a way that you find it easier to read, making little paragraphs, introducing new lines in between. When one process is finished, make a new line. Maybe in the first place also add a comment and telling, yeah, well, here we are reading the products. Now we are filtering the products. And after that, you can take these pieces and look if you want to extract some of them into a method. If you find complex conditions, like if statements or loop statements, which have conditions with 2, 3 or more parts, it's a really good idea to just extract these into a method. Because it's really hard to read through these conditions all and every time to understand what is actually meant to be the condition here. But ripping that out and telling, like, if product has warranty instead of looking that the product isn't older than these years, is of a specific type, is not owned by 3 persons, or whatever, has an additional insurance, and so on. You can just extract these things. We will also take a look at that. If you have, well, we have the speaking names already. If you have too many parameters for a single method, it might be a good indicator that you're missing some object structure. Just look if these parameters maybe partly belong together. We had just the example with x coordinate, y coordinate, width, height, and so on. We could say like, well, this describes a shape or something like that, or it describes dimensions. So we might rather create a dimensions object and transmit one dimensions object to the method. It makes it much more readable than having these 8 parameters in a row. Also, it allows us to add more parameters without changing code in many, many places, because we can just add a new optional value to the class we just created, and then nobody else needs to take care of except one place where we actually need that. So encapsulating multiple parameters into a common object, maybe just a DTO, data transfer object, is a very good thing. Who of you is working in the Easy world? Easy Publish? Okay, you should be finding structs somewhere around in the new kernel, if I remember correct. This is pretty much what I'm talking about here. I'm not sure if they removed them, actually. So, the same applies to multiple return values. Whenever you want to return multiple things from a method, please never use an array. Of course, if you want to return a list of things, yes, but if you need to return like 2-3 variables from the method, it's the ideal case you're missing an object there. Just create an object. Just don't return like the first element is the width, the second element is the height, or the third element is something, or even return a hash map. It's like really bad because you don't have autocomplete on that one. You don't have hints on that one from your IDE what it actually exists. If you make a typo, nobody will recover that. If you now have split down classes and if you have crafted many, many nice methods in there and extracted from your logical blocks many methods, you start splitting classes by context, like which methods operate on a common set of attributes, but this is even further down the road. So first starting with these smaller steps, ripping the pieces apart, already brings you much, much further on. Generally, whenever we craft a method or whenever we rework a method, we should try to make it not have any side effects, especially not modify its arguments. So whenever you change an argument or you want to change an argument, rather return a new value and let the new value be the changed one. So the controlling code in the outside can decide if the original should be replaced or not. This is what we call immutability. Try to not access globals. This is completely out of sense for object-oriented programming, accessing global state. Work on the local state which you have. Wrap side effects in dedicated classes and methods. We already talked about that. Command query separation. Try to craft methods which only do one thing. Either change something or return some information. This is not always possible, but in many, many cases. And don't mix various levels of abstraction. Okay, so if we talk about side effects in PHP, PHP is a language which has the possibility to produce side effects quite easily. One of the most annoying side effects is that you have non-PHP parts in your PHP file. So whoever had the thing that there was some output generated so we could not send any headers in his application later on. So I want to have all of your hands up now because everybody has suffered from that one. So you have some blank line or something after the closing PHP tag somewhere, and so output is generated and you want to send a header, and PHP tells you cannot send header because you already generated output. Yeah, so this is one of the most annoying side effects we can generate in our PHP because it's something which we definitely do not want to have. And so we should follow one of the recent coding standards and just leave the PHP closing tag completely out. Big recommendation, remove all your PHP closing tags anytime. What else side effects do we know? We already discussed some of them. So do you know more side effects? Whenever you do some of them, it's a side effect. It affects an external system. It affects the browser in our case, or the shell. It's not something which is in our PHP environment anymore. It's not local memory. So whenever you output something in your PHP script, it's a side effect. What does that mean in terms of clean code? I I thought you had coffee, so you should be awake now. No worries, I'm not biting. Hey. Oh, wait, not thinking. So think. What does it mean if these commands produce side effects? We just heard. Yes, it produces output. So how should we handle these functions? Okay, start the output buffer. Well, that's one possibility. Well, that means that you should encapsulate the places where these side effects are generated into certain cases, like into one special part of your application, like the view layer, for example. Do not simply echo something anywhere. Of course, for debugging purposes, you can do that. But in production code, you should not have an echo somewhere in between in your database class, for example. It's one single point where you should do all the echoing. So having a response object, for example, which encapsulates all the things which should be echoed later on, the render template and what so on, should be there. And there's one place where we simply take the content and print it out. Same applies to writing get, post, session, and server. While you should not never write into three of them, writing into the session should be encapsulated in one place so we can easily find it and easily get rid of that. Why would you get rid of writing into the session? What could be a reason that we get rid of writing into a session? Anybody has an idea? Did you ever want to get rid of writing into a session in your application? Okay, this is more like a performance impact.
But it's a side effect.
Yes, it's a side effect. I mean, this is where actually the side effect session comes from. Yeah, absolutely true. Writing and locking the session file. So what do you do if you want to write a unit test? Do you want to write into session then? No, you won't. You want to avoid all these side effects during unit test phase because it will eventually disturb other code runnings. And if you once have a failure there, this failure might impact many, many, many other tests. So you want to get rid of these. Same applies to accessing globals. We just talked about mental model that you need in order to understand the code. As soon as you access something global, your mental model explodes. It's not possible anymore for you to keep a sane model of what the code does in your brain because you don't know which other parts of the code access the same global and what it means to them if you change it, or what other parts of the code changed it. So writing files, databases, of course, web services also. You should write a client class, and this is the only class that is really doing things against the web service. It's not doing anywhere fopen in your code and firing something against the web service. Including files. Well, as long as there are only dedicated methods and objects doing that, fine. But including them anywhere in your code, not a good idea. Producing side effects. And there's more. So you will find even more things I listed up here I don't even know of. Just watch your code and see where it actually does things which impact not only the local code, but other parts of your code or even other systems. And this brings us to the next practice. So to bring you in thinking mode again, look through your code, see if you find side effects in your code. How are they handled? Maybe you can just search using your IDE or grep on the shell for things that create side effects. Are they handled properly? What could you maybe do to fix improperly handled side effects? Could you maybe create a method? Could you create a client class or something like that to encapsulate that? In addition, check if your code really reads like a book, like a newspaper to you. 15 minutes of time. Again, if you have something to show, please tweet it to me or fetch some paper here to write down a short URL so that we can look into that after the 15 minutes of practice. Shoot. Oh, so yeah, there is this discussion about templates with PHP. We just saw like a template where there was lots of HTML and embedded PHP. Of course, if you use PHP as a template language, then inside these templates, you will not come around producing these side effects. What the real thing is behind that is inside your application, you will have something like a template engine, which is the only one loading these templates and therefore indirectly producing these side effects, right? So this is the meaning of encapsulation of side effects from your application in that case. Well, it's a very good thing because, well, using PHP as a template language is awesome, but please don't do that inside your controller, for example, like echo something in the controller, because that is not decoupling these things. So what else do we have? Anyone else tweeted something? Oh yeah, we have exit and die, which are both not named on my slides and which are also most horrible side effects on the PHP application, because whenever we use them in production, we hopefully have like nothing outputted before or not a half-baked page outputted before, because it will simply end the application at all and we don't do any cleanup. So for example, if you have temporarily files written for to disk, it's not going to be cleaned up. If you have pending database transactions, they are rolled back and so on. So we affect the whole code in our object-oriented application, which was not executed by now or which is still awaiting to be executed, by simply avoiding to execute it. So do we have more? Also an awesome example. That is like a twig function. Somebody wrote a twig function which stored and saved, changed something while rendering. So this is basically putting the nice encapsulation of having twig as a template language and the twig renderer as the central point which is allowed to actually perform output or to render stuff. Encapsulating these things which should not change the state of our system and then changing the state in the background. So finding these bugs or a bug which is in there, have fun. It will be really, really nice. Really good example. So, yes, this one? No. Okay. Not that I see. This one. No. Yeah, that's the right one. Yes. Why did they ever change that? Like, I just want abusing global variables. Let me check. Maybe. If I could. I can do control shift reload, but well. Yeah. That one? That was the tray, that is the controller. Okay, what else do we have? That is again the tray. So, what is your nick? Deb something. Okay. Can't find that. Can you type it in? You have switched the tweets to protected. That is why I didn't see them here, maybe. Okay. I have no clue. I'm sorry. Okay, so let's look into some of the examples I got here. So this is, I think it was a controller function, right? And inside the controller function, we have raw SQL, which actually creates a table. Awesome thing. That is what we expect in a controller function. Luckily, it was in a controller, because that is where people typically look the first. But still, like, executing SQL statements at all should be encapsulated in some kind of pattern. And, well, using data definition language should even be more encapsulated, hopefully outside of the main application code. Like, creating tables from your controllers is also opening up maybe a security risk. So that's not really a good idea of doing. What did we have here? Who tweeted that one? Can you tell me again where to look at?
The second line after the if, you have a session alter.
Okay, so you are accessing the application session and then set some variable in there. Okay. So we are doing multiple side effects in one if. Actually, I don't find it that bad, because it's still encapsulated in some object, which is then actually doing the original side effect. So while having access to the session and the database and so on through one big app object, looks like this thing does way too much. So, and we have the trade example we found. So there was a method clear entity manager, clear EM. And we were wondering, like, okay, where does it come from? Having the clearing of the entity manager inside a method encapsulated is nice in itself. But now we have this whole thing in a trade, and this trade is used like all over the place. So instead of having one object which we can mock in our tests, for example, we don't have the possibility to mock the trait anymore. And it's just copying and pasting the code for the side effects all over again. And the other thing is, we have clear entity manager, which would induce, like, there is a side effect, we are clearing and flushing the entity manager. Flushing, not sure if this is implied by the name clear, but we have additional side effects, because we are actually doing echo here inside, which is something which you should also not do, except for the method clearly states, like, this is outputting something. Okay, did you manage to fix your Twitter account? Okay, let's go back to the... Oh, we have the initset here. Oh, I can... Yeah, you should retweet that. I'm also not sure if we can spend so much time on that. I'm sorry. We have the ini set here, which is also a side effect which is not mentioned on my slides. So in general, doing ini set is one of the worst side effects you can introduce in your PHP application. So getting rid of that is a very, very good idea. Okay, so we had that. We don't have enough time. So I will roughly skip through the topic of error handling. Whenever you want to implement something like handling errors, you should stick to the object-oriented way of doing things. So in procedural programming, we used to do error codes, like returning anything else than zero from a function, indicated this is an error, and the number returned hopefully indicates what type of error that is. This is a really bad idea of doing, because that means that you need to handle each and every error in the place where it actually occurs, and need to transmit the errors manually to the parent. So whenever you have something like that, you need to take care manually of errors. If you use warnings and notices in your application, it's also a very bad idea, because some misconfiguration simply leads to... What? So what is it basically if you misconfigure your PHP and somebody is using warnings and notices? That is like the right configuration, because that doesn't produce it. If you have like display errors and you have error reporting to show notices and warnings? Well, it's a side effect. It causes output to be generated, and that interferes with errors. So whenever you get output from warnings and notices, you're doomed in sending headers out of your PHP application. And that will most probably break your whole algorithm. So don't use them. Also, if you return null somewhere or use null somewhere, this might be a valid case. Like if you are trying to find some object in the database and it doesn't exist, returning null might be quite useful because that is not an error, maybe. Maybe it is an error if you are required to have that object, then you could throw an exception. But if you, for example, want to submit some object, like a logger to some object, and you then submit null and have the default value, and you have all these checks all over, like if it is null, if it is null, if it is null, then it is really a problem. So in this case, you should simply not use null, but some null object pattern. In the end, using exceptions for errors is a very, very good idea. It's important that you distinguish between real error situations and logical situations which are behaving or which mean the user does not behave correctly. Like if you type an incorrect password, this should not be an exception. This is something which your application should deal with and display a nice message to the user. It's not something which your application says like, I can't work anymore like that. I will skip the examples how to throw exceptions. You can read that up on the slides later on if you want to, or you already know that. What is important is that you should, in some place, catch all exceptions which are thrown in your application. So having a global exception handler is a really, really good idea to avoid that users see broken pages. What is also quite important is that you only handle exceptions in the case where you really can handle them. So any of you ever worked with Java? Java programmers? So there is this thing that Java enforces you to either handle an exception or declare that it is thrown. Do you know what happened in the Java world after they introduced that? People are only using runtime exceptions today because they don't have to be declared or caught. So what that means is exceptions should only be caught whenever they can really be handled. So if you have a module which displays the current weather on your website, yeah, some widget which does that, and it does not work, you simply don't care. You simply show a message on a website saying, sorry, weather is right now unavailable. There is no need to catch the exception in the web service handler, catch the exception in the controller, catch the exception on application level, rethrow it, whatever things. So make up your mind, where can you really deal with an exception? And otherwise, let it just bubble up if you cannot deal with it. If you throw exceptions, you should provide some additional context if possible, like what is the logged in user for debugging purposes, which you can log back later. If you get external libraries in your code, try to wrap the exception which is coming out there into your own things so you have full control over which exceptions are bubbling up in your application. Maybe it contains sensitive information in the message, like this is a password or something like that. So it might be a security flaw to just let exceptions from external libraries bubble up. And always install a global exception handler, of course. So, last two things we will be talking about today. I think we are pretty short of time. Yeah, quite a little. If we are talking about comments, what do you think? The more comments, the better? Is that the thing to go?
No. Depends.
Depends?
Yeah.
Why?
Depends on the context. If your application is large enough and it has really a lot of moving parts that you just can't reference the time and they're changing, sometimes it is good to have like a lot of comments or one big ass one on the class. Just to explain where is it used, how is it used, and why is it used. Basically, explaining the business rule and business case for the existence of the class and the way it is used.
Okay, so the answer is it depends. If your application gets large, well, of course it depends. It always depends. If I understood you correct, you said like if your application gets large enough, there is a high risk that comments are outdated, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
But not only that, the application becomes so large and the business rules are so many and it is used in different contexts, so you need to actually like write it down. Why is it used? Why do you do it this way?
Okay, so well, you say like if the business rules are so complex that you need to actually write down why something happens. I would consider that actually not documentation inside the class, inside the code, but rather like a design document or architectural documentation in a wiki or somewhere. I would not put it into the code, basically. But I agree that it might be necessary. Still. Well, this is a very, very good learning from this workshop already. What he said is like, if we name things better, we would need less comments. And this is one thing which is behind there. So there are a lot of bad comments in our code, most probably. So some of you claim they already write clean code. I doubt that. I cannot write clean code myself. I need to improve over and over again. A bad comment explains code which is not expressive in itself. So this is actually what you just said. If we could do better naming, then the algorithm should be talking to us, then we don't need code which explains why the code does something in a certain way. Other bad comments are simply repeating the code. So you all know these auto-generated comments from methods. We have a method which is called getID, and the comment says, gets the ID. Awesome, really nice. Especially, pardon? Yes, underscore construct with the comment class constructor. Awesome, really great things. The best thing is when you repeat the code in the comment and somebody changes the code, then you get that outdated comments. And that's the worst thing you can have because it confuses you highly if you read like, this returns an integer and then it returns an object. It's like, whoa, what is wrong here? So if you attempt to repeat the code, just remove the comment. If you see comments which just repeat the code, simply delete them. It's as easy as that. Also, if you have comments, when you discover something new in programming, it's a very typical habit to add a comment to each of the lines to remind you what you did there. Like, well, I have to call it like this because it expects these and these parameters. I have to call fetch first and then close and so on. So that might be useful for you for the learning, for just writing it down. But after that, you should delete these comments because it simply pollutes the flow of code. And everybody else is like looking, oh, well, yeah, I know that you have to do that. Oh, is there something important in? No, no important information. Whoa, what was the code 3 lines above? It's really not a good thing to clutter your application with lots of comments. Instead, what a good comment does, it gives an advice for the future user. And I think this is what you actually meant, explaining the user rather complex situations in your code, why something is realized in a certain way, or how things should be realized. So, for example, if you tell like, okay, the template class should not be used directly, but only in combination with a template renderer. This is useful information. This is useful to write down. Or we handle things in a certain way here because we had a performance issue or something like that. Also, if you comment, try to be as clear and straightforward as possible. Write as small comments as possible. I like writing very, very much. So I'm also writing blog articles and newspaper articles. I even wrote a book. I always need to keep myself back when writing comments because I want to explain everything and it's all so nice and shiny. But if I have a comment blog of this length, nobody will ever read it. So I should make it really short. People are lazy. People won't read it. If you need to have complex situations, it's good to explain them, but only if they are really complex. So one of my favorite examples is complex regular expressions. Did you ever use the regular expression to validate an email? The real one, like the official one which validates it from the standard, not the one with like .star @.star or something? There is like an official, you can Google that, there is an official regular expression which is exactly like, it's that long, and it really validates if an email is formally correct. If you use that thing and you copy and paste it from wherever you found it on the internet, just write a comment there. So I found this on the internet, please don't try to debug it. This is a really good comment. Also, if you have unusual implementations, like for example, you would rather make it clean, but for performance reason, you step back and said like, okay, I'm now inlining these multiple for each loops because we had a performance issue there. You should also add a comment for that. So this is really important parts where you need comments. Warning of danger also, like calling this method more than whatever times will give you performance issues. Or if you call that without an initialized something, then else will implode or whatever will happen then. In addition, in PHP versions before 7, we also should add comments for Scala values and return values. So if you have parameters which are int, float, string or something, or arrays, you should also add that. Array is a type-in since 5.3, I think, and in PHP 7 we also have Scala type-ins, so we can avoid these comments because now we have a language construct to actually use them. You all know, hopefully, how that works. I'm skipping through that. Do we have time for this practice? Not really. So, I'm skipping the practice. I'm sorry, but you should do that at home or maybe in your project team and discuss about which comments are useful and which not. I can instead jump into some of the example code to make it clear what I mean. So if you downloaded the thing, you should also have that documentation practice. So what about these changelog things here? What do you think? Good or bad comment? Why? Why is it bad? Pardon?
I have Git.
Yes, you have a version control system for that. So if somebody wants to see the history of your file, he can look it up in version control, deleting it. What about license? Well, if you have it in the root location of your application, that's much better, having a license file. If you do open source or if you do commercial software which is run on other clients' systems, but having the license in each and every file, I mean, in some open source projects it's mandatory, but in the end it's always only cluttering your stuff. So we just remove it. So then we have extensive comments on the class. We have a coffee machine which extends coffee maker, and we have a hint on a policy coffee maker. Good or bad comment? Yeah, no need, because it's already in the code. Why should we duplicate the code? Removing it. I won't go through this thing, but most probably this is way too extensive. So then we have a coffee machine fills cups with fresh brewed coffee. Well, I have class coffee machine, and I have public function fill with parameter cup as the first place. Let me guess. I would rather go and delete it. Then we have the method fill. It receives a cup, and the first line comment is. So, this is quite interesting. It says, like, the cup is filled until it's full. Well, very, very unexpected. Cup size is detected for certain brands. If no brand is detected, 0.25 liter is assumed. Is this a good comment? Pardon? I still didn't get you, I'm sorry. Oh, yes. To you, yes. So, I would rather say, like, this is a good comment, definitely. Yes. It's a warning, like, if you use a cup with an unsupported brand, you should rather check that it really complies to that, or you need to touch the code. So, this is really good. This is the first comment in the file which we found, which we say, like, okay, leave it here. It's important. It's a good hint for the future reader to state something which is not obvious from the code itself. We have these author annotations, which you can find a lot. Good or bad? Okay, so why do you consider them okay on class level? Yes. So what about if Bob is leaving the company? What does this annotation help you for? Oh, you can blame everything on Bob. So, yeah, but it's true. It's actually true. So these kind of things trigger normally something like, whoa, it's bullshit, Bob wrote it. Or, oh, Bob wrote it, I shouldn't touch it, he will be angry. So I would rather simply remove that. It disturbs the feeling of working together and feeling responsible even for other people's code. Right? So it's arguable, but I can, if I want to know who to ask why something is written in a certain way, I can do git blame.
Okay. What about if you write an author in chat?
It's the very same thing for me. I mean, if you're working on an open source project and you want to give credits to the author, it's okay, but I would rather go and create a large authors file and put all authors in there so they don't disturb the code. I would rather get rid of these. I know some people still do it. I'm not doing it anymore. No author annotation. If I want to know whom to ask, I use git blame. So, and we can move on. Like, yeah, for copyright reasons, I would also have a copyright file which states that. But yeah, I know that some companies have policies in that direction. But all open source projects, yeah. I find it annoying. But well, discussable. Okay, so you see, I could get rid of many, many, many comments here which are really, really explicit, but I also found a very, very good comment here, and this one I really like. So we have, if you look into the examples, there's much more like this, for example. Yeah, of course. This regular expression matches senseo or milita. No matter what case. This is distinguishable, I don't know. Who of you is familiar with regular expressions so it's easy for them to read? Okay, so undecided. I would rather keep it there for explaining the regular expression. What about this one? Especially the second line, this one. It's a hint to refactor. What do we think about hints to refactor? Okay, so instead of just writing this comment, we should just have made it that way. That would be much more intuitive. So changing these five lines of code instead of typing a comment and telling the future reader like, hey, do you have 5 minutes of time for changing that? Well, not sure. Okay, so do you think coding styles matter in your application? Do you have a coding style in your team? Yes, please raise your hand if you have a coding style. Oh, so you have like, what's it called in English? A whip for code quality? Okay. Oh, I don't know how to translate that in English, actually. I'm sorry. Okay, so having a coding style, is it important or not? It is? Why? Okay, it's important to use one style. Yeah. So do not mix styles in the project. Why? Yeah, so it's really distracting if you need to switch in your brain between different coding styles. It's like if you read a book and there are various authors writing that book, it's really hard to read the different chapters which were written by different authors in different styles. So it's the very same in coding projects. Also, yeah, well, if we have a coding style, it is much faster to navigate. Like, you know where the public functions are, where the private functions are, where to look for names and so on, for what names you can search, how to list stuff and so on. it in addition supports collective code ownership. So if you have different coding styles, as a human, you automatically build patterns in your brain and assign different coding styles to different teams or different persons. And it again gives you a feeling of, well, I shouldn't touch it. It's code from the other team. It's not my business. And this is what we want to get out of. We want to get into the business. We want to feel responsible for collective code. So improving all code where we ever go. And we want to make feel developers at home, not like, well, this is so annoying to work with it. It's a different coding style and so on. So coding style is really important, especially consistent coding style, what you already said. What should coding style work on? So we should code like a newspaper. This is like the high-level coding standard. We have a descriptive and short headline, which is the class name or the method name. Then we have the most important facts, what is the internal working of the class, what is the construction precondition of the class. Then we have important explanations on how the class works, public methods. Then we have the private methods and so on. So this is a very good thing. Beside that, we already had that before. We should be sticking to PSR. Who of you is using PSR? You are trying to do pretty good. That's already a pretty good rate. So Lucas once said on the peer mailing list like 15 years ago, I don't care if you find the coding style ugly. It is a coding style and we stick to it. And this is an important thing. I personally changed my coding style 4 times in my life now. I hope I don't need to change it in the future anymore, but if I come to a project where I need to stick to a new style, I will do it because it's important for the project to do so. But I would be much more happy if people just stick to PSR2 and everybody has at least a certain degree on what can be expected in a project. So we have PSR0. PSR is the PHP standardization request system from the PHP Framework Interoperability Group. Actually, we have some people in here. Are you part of the group? No. But we have someone at the conference here who is part of the group. I heard yesterday. Ooh. So these are people from different frameworks and applications sitting together, smashing their heads off what the best coding style and stuff is and what the best way of writing things is. And we should simply follow that, at least until PSR2. After that, it's again discussable in my mind. So what does it do? The first thing is, how do we place files on disk? How does autoloading work? How do classes map to files? Very, very important. If you follow PSR0 or PSR4, people can simply find the classes they are looking for very, very easily. Then we have the basic coding style rules in PSR1 and the detailed coding style rules in PSR2. And yes, it is 4 spaces for indentation. No tabs, not 8 spaces. And yes, it's curly braces on different levels. Live with it. Just stick to it. Do yourself a favor and migrate your project to PSR. You will make me very happy and all developers joining your team in the future, hopefully. Yes. In the extended version of the slides, I'm mentioning it. So there is the PHP coding style fixer, which can fix partly the coding style for you. I ran it in one project and it said like, whoa, okay, I'd rather do it manually. I'm not sure if it is improved by now. Yeah. So PHP Storm also helps you quite a lot with that. There are tools out there which help you to switch your coding style. Still, you should probably add stuff on it, like what are your naming rules? How do you name certain concepts? What names to avoid? And so on, which you should add on top of these basic coding standards, most probably. So, these are just the very, very basic things we discussed today in clean code. What I hope to trigger in you is the feeling that with even these small measurements, you can make your code a lot better. Clean code also talks about object-oriented modeling in some part. So sticking to subtype polymorphism and what it means if you derive a certain type and which rules you need to apply in order to not break anyone's code. There are different object types and how they are handled. Immutability and so on is mentioned in the guidelines. Very important topics. Inversion of control and what that means is also mentioned there. I have no time today to dig into that, and there is even more in clean code, like writing tests and so on. I can only recommend to you to read the book, get it on track, and to get the mental state into your team that it is required with every action that you leave the code you just touched in a better state than before. This is really the important part. So many of our customers, when they first approach us, tell us like, oh, we are doing domain-driven design now. That makes everything better. Or the recent thing is, oh, we do microservices now. Now our application will be much better. In 99% of the cases, that's bullshit. I'm sorry. 99% of the cases, it's rather go for cleaning up your code, refactoring it smaller steps into a cleaner state. This will gain you much more than jumping on one of the new fancy bandwagons which you want to try to apply. This is what developers most likely don't want to hear, but, well, in many, many, many cases, it's really true. Clean code gives you a really, really good basis. It's a quite old book. The principles mentioned in these books are even older. They are just from proven techniques which over time have proven to lead to better code. So just sticking to that, if you once are in a state where you say like, well, all code is 95% clean, you can try to top up with other things. There are some more principles like solid, for example, which you should also get in mind, but most of the principles are also mentioned in clean code. So just sticking to that one and improving over time more and more and more brings you in a much better state than trying to rip one of the shiny, new, fancy concept things and trying to apply that to your code. It's everything which seems shiny and new is always experimental. So if you jump on that and try it out, you are taking part in an experiment and seeing like, well, does it lead to what we want? Especially that microservices topic. Maybe you have seen the tweet recently about the new shiny Twitter microservice architecture and the dependencies between the microservices. If you look at that, you think like, well, you did it. You created a microservice monolith. Awesome. So sticking to clean code and doing small steps to improve your code, in my eyes, it's a much better version of improving your code. I have a little outlook for you, what you also can try upon. So for introducing clean code in smaller steps in your team and also tackling the larger refactorings which might be necessary, you can introduce an advanced version of the Boy Scout rule, which is whenever you find something bad in the code, when you touch it, try to fix it within the next 10 minutes. If you manage to do so, awesome. You managed to get, what was the quote you had from Uncle Bob? You did a random act of kindness to your code and your team, awesome. Perfectly. If you don't manage to fix it, after 10 minutes, revert. Add an annotation which says add refactor. I think this code needs to be cleaned up. It gave me some pain here. So I want it to be cleaner, I need it to be cleaner to better work with it. If you already found such an add refactor, append an exclamation mark to it. If there are already exclamation marks, add a new one. So you do that for like some weeks, 4, 8, some sprints. And after that, you search for your code for add refactor and sort discending by the number of exclamation marks. And then you see where there's the biggest pain in your code, which is most touched and gave the most pain to your developers. And then you approach this with a larger refactoring technique and say like, well, this is the place where we touch first. It's a really, really good approach if in legacy projects where you think like, oh, I want to throw it all away and rewrite it. Rewriting is mostly not a good decision. Instead, you should rather go with small techniques moving in the right direction. So introducing clean code in your project could be working on that basis. Like, we agree upon, we want to rename stuff to make it more clear in the next three sprints as side by working. So if you find a class which is used often, which you cannot easily rename within 3 minutes, you can add such an add refactor thing here. And then you find the classes which everybody are annoyed of in the application, and then do a dedicated ticket on that 2 to 3 hours to rename that class properly or rename that method. Works quite well. I've seen that in many teams by now. It helps you, yeah, to approach the largest pain points first, which is really important. If you go to refactor in terms of clean code, this will most probably not work without tests, which is a bad thing for legacy applications, because legacy applications typically don't have tests, and so you would rather need to write them, but writing unit tests for legacy code is also a big pain. It's not really working. There is a method of hacking some functional tests, which give you the security line for easier refactoring. I prepared a little demo just to get you an insight of what I'm doing. So, for example, we have a browser emulator here, which is called Sahi. I'm running that. And in one of our example tools, there we have functional tests which are written in PHP Unit using the Mink library. This is what we do quite often to refactor legacy applications. And if you run them, you see that there is, on the one hand, code executed, which is the actual test. And on the other hand, the browser opens and all the functional tests are executed through the browser, through this browser emulator. So this thing actually performs your click passes, which you would do on the shell, and it does it for you through the browser. And that lowers the barrier for writing tests for legacy applications quite a lot. So doing functional tests through the browser is a really, really good thing for ensuring that you can do larger refactorings in a safe way. So are we done yet? No. Still running. I love looking into these things magically filling in browser things and so on. So really happy. Yay! We have 49 seconds, 6 tests, okay. So, what's the time? Am I right in time? Wow, 15 minutes early. So, other questions? Should we look into something some more? No? Okay. Then I say thank you for listening. I hope you enjoyed the session. It was a little bit different from the other sessions, I think. Please tell me if you like it. You can tell it to me in person, or you can give a voting, or you can tweet, or whatever things. Yeah, if you want to get me on site on your team and get a workshop, feel free to contact me here at the conference, or send me an email, and then see you later for the tequila.